As of today, I can assure you, nothing in the mathematical description of the laws of physics requires you to time travel naked. Hi, I'm Brian Greene, professor of physics at Columbia University and author of a book called Until the End of Time, Mind, Matter, and Our Search for Meaning in an Evolving Universe. And I'm here today to discuss some of the weirdnesses of time and the possibilities or not of time travel. Back to the Future, you know, classic film where Marty McFly goes back in time. And that film actually illustrates one of the puzzles of time travel if going to the past is possible. Because in principle, you ask yourself, what if I go back and I affect things in the past that may even prevent my own birth, right? That's what Marty McFly does. His presence in the past seems to have the possibility of keeping his parents from meeting. And the weird thing that they do in that film, which works visually, but scientifically is bizarre, Marty McFly, he at one point looks at his hand when his parents seemingly are not going to meet, and he starts to dissolve. He looks at a photograph, and the characters in the future that were in that photograph, they start to fade away in the photo. That's not how things would happen, right? If you could change the past, you can't, in my view, and many other physicists, but if you could change the past, that change would immediately affect everything subsequent. It wouldn't sort of take its time to ripple through time. That'd be a different kind of time. So if your parents never met, you would not be born, period. End of story. It's a black and white thing. It's not a sort of you're half there and therefore partly translucent. It looks good on screen, but has nothing to do with our understanding of the world. But yeah, that is a deep question. Could you change the past? And I don't think that you can, because moments in time just are. There's no such thing as a moment in time changing, because that would require time for the change to transpire. And moments, by definition, don't have that. They are the atoms of time. They're the ingredients of time. So if you're going to do time travel to the past, to do it right, you want to make sure that anything that the time traveler does in the past locks in to the unfolding of reality in a manner that allows them in the future to be there and to effectuate whatever action they took in the past. I love Back to the Future. I love all of the films in that series, but in terms of whether any of it at all aligns with our understanding of the world from science, I don't think any of it's right.
My final report until we reach touchdown. We're now on full automatic in the hands of the computers. I've tucked my crew in for the long...
I first encountered the possibility of time being weird in the original film Planet of the Apes. Not the new one, but the old one, way back in the 1960s. Yeah, I'm kind of an old guy, right? So I was a kid when I saw the first version of Planet of the Apes. And I remember there's this scene where the astronaut, played by Charlton Heston, is on the bridge of this ship and he's looking at the chronometer on the ship. I think while he's also chomping on like a cigar, you know, he's that kind of character. And he sees that the chronometer on the ship has gone thousands of years into the future because, as he says, the ship traveled near the speed of light. And I remember as a kid seeing that chronometer and knowing it was like 1970 something, and that chronometer was like, you know, way into the future, and it was like mind blowing, thousands of years into the future. Well, when I was a kid, I had no idea whether any of the stuff in Planet of the Apes, especially traveling to the future, whether that could be real. But later on, when I began to study Einstein's ideas, it became clear that scientists had known for a long time that time travel of that sort toward the future, that kind of time travel is real. I mean, what Einstein taught us is that if you travel very quickly, your clock compared to a stationary clock will tick off time at a different rate. And indeed, if someone on Earth is looking at someone in a spaceship going out into space near the speed of light, turning around and coming back, they will recognize that that clock is running slow compared to their own, which means when the astronaut comes out of that ship, they perhaps have aged 1 year, whereas everybody else on Earth will have aged thousands of years or millions or billions of years. It all simply depends on how close to the speed of light you travel. That's real. The final scene in Planet of the Apes is again one of those, at least for me, even still kind of a mind-blowing moment. But I do remember as a kid having a sense of the world is the way it is and will kind of always be that way. I think that's the sense of comfort that we as young minds often impose on the world around us. And to see in that finale scene, the Statue of Liberty half buried in the sand, whereas like I had recently gone to the Statue of Liberty for the first time with my school group. And to see that buried in the ground was a real moment of, yeah, things can change and things can go downhill. There isn't some sense of certainty about what the future will be like. And that certainly inspired me to try to understand what science could tell us about the future. And in a way, it's really influenced the kind of work that I've done ever since.
Here we go!
So speeding through space is not the only way to travel through time, because Einstein gave us another way of traveling through time, and that has to do with the force of gravity. Because in his general theory of relativity, Einstein showed us that gravity doesn't just pull on mass, doesn't just pull on energy. In a sense, gravity pulls on time. So if you're near a strong source of gravity, time for you will slow down. And I myself made use of that idea in a short story that we made a live presentation with film about. It's called Icarus at the Edge of Time, where this boy, like Icarus in the original Greek myth, that boy flew too near the sun with wax wings and died. In this retelling of that tale that I wrote, the boy again goes against his father's wishes, but this time he flies a little ship toward the edge of a black hole and explores the edge of a black hole. And then he comes back to show his dad what he has done, but he forgot about general relativity. So even though he was near that black hole for only an hour, when he comes back in this story, it's 10,000 years into the future, because his clock was ticking off time so slowly compared to the clocks that were not near the black hole. So in this version, he doesn't die, but he has to acclimate to a new reality dictated by Einstein's ideas.
What's going on here? Where's Proxima?
This idea was also vital to the Hollywood film Interstellar. So in Interstellar, you have characters who go near a black hole. Astronauts, I think their name was Cooper and Brand, Romilly, I'm probably getting the names wrong. But anyway, they travel to a planet near a black hole. And two of those characters spend like an hour down on that planet. Wondrous things happen there. There's an enormous tidal wave of water, which comes from the pull of the black hole on the water on that planet. You know, it was a deadly moment in the film, but sort of a beautiful one from the point of view of animation. But when the characters return to the ship, again, they've only aged a couple of hours, but their crew member back on the ship, who's far away from the black hole, his clock was ticking off time fast compared to theirs, so he's like 20 years older than when they left just a few hours ago.
I've waited years. How many years? By now it must be.
It's 23 years, 4 months, 8 days.
And that kind of time travel to the future, they have traveled to the future of their crew member, their crewmate, that kind of time travel, again, is completely in keeping with our understanding of the laws of physics that come to us from Einstein in his theories of relativity. Yeah, if you're gonna be a time traveler using black holes, if you have aced your exams in the general theory of relativity, if you really understood the subject, you will be able to pinpoint how far into the future you are going to travel, because it all depends on how close you get to the edge of a black hole, what we call the event horizon. And you, in principle, can't control that distance. You know, physiologically, whether your body could withstand the acceleration and the forces that you feel, that's a different story. Let's put that biological question to the side, just focus on the physics. But yeah, you can dial up how close you get to the edge. You can determine how long, according to your clock, you will stay there. And that's all the input you need to determine what the time will be when you emerge from the edge of the black hole. Yeah, so you could pinpoint this.
License to broadcast, buddy.
Look, I really don't remember how this thing works.
Listen, you can't broadcast.
There's another film called Frequency that took on this issue of the interplay between future and past. It's actually a film that I advised on, and they asked me if I would be in it. The plot line is that there's a father and a son separated by 30 years that somehow through an old ham radio are able to communicate with each other across 30 years. The dad actually is long gone. He died in a fire. And to set up this notion of a time warp, what the filmmakers did, they asked me if I would be interviewed in two television sets in the two scenes, interviewed by Dick Cavett. He's a famous American talk show host in the old days. So in one scene, they had me, you know, very young, and the other television set, they had me looking old 30 years later. That was an experience, putting on the prosthetic face that they made for me. They put that plaster of Paris on my face. I almost freaked, man. I thought I was being buried alive. They had to bring someone over, hold my hand while the plaster of Paris dried. So embarrassing. Ridiculous. But anyway, so in the film, you know, they used that to make me look older. And a colleague of mine, very nice colleague of mine in the math department at Columbia, recently said to me, how does it feel to now look like that old version of yourself that was depicted in that film? I was like, man, thanks. But one thing they did in Frequency, sort of against my advice, but it works in the film. So there's this moment when the dad, 30 years in the past, he's smoking a cigarette or something, and it causes a little fire on his desktop while he's talking to his son. The fire burns a little mark into the desk, and we see that burn mark suddenly appear in the future. We even see the smoke, if I'm not mistaken, in the future, as if it happened at that very moment. Again, that's not how it would work if you could change the past. That burn mark would have been in that table 30 years prior to that moment, and it would have been there every single moment since. It wouldn't suddenly appear in the present. If you recognize that moments in time just are, there aren't multiple versions of a given moment in time, that's a kind of incoherent notion, then if you were to travel through time, your presence at any given moment would always be. There would never be a version of that moment when you were not there, and therefore your presence would be locked into the way reality itself unfolds. There wouldn't be a version in which you wouldn't be there. I think the characters' name are Henry and Claire. Henry is the time traveler. Claire ultimately is Henry's wife, and there is a moment in which Henry meets Claire for the first time, and he's, you know, excited to meet her. But Claire has been expecting this moment for many years because she already met the future version of Henry at an earlier moment in her past. And so Henry's not aware of it because it's only his future self that has met the younger Claire. But Claire, because meeting Henry for the first time from Henry's perspective, is in her future. So it locks together into a perfectly logical and coherent story in which everything happens, nothing ever changes. It's just mind-bending to think of the intricate web of connections through time that time travel would create. But that's a far more sensible way of thinking about how time travel would work. Now, the one thing that I would say about that film, which is a little bit weird, is when Henry travels through time, he always winds up naked at the new destination. Yeah, I'd have, maybe when we fully understand quantum gravity, we'll be able to recognize that this is an absolute necessity of time travel. But as of today, I can assure you, nothing in the mathematical description of the laws of physics requires you to time travel naked. the closest we have to something that might yield a time machine is something called a wormhole. And a wormhole is simply a tunnel that connects, in general, you know, say one point in space with another point in space. That's what an ordinary tunnel does, right? You want to go from one side of a mountain to the other. You don't want to go up the top and down, so you tunnel right through. It gives a shortcut. A wormhole is a shortcut through space-time itself. And often we explain this by taking a piece of paper and folding the two corners next to each other and say, look, if you wanted to go from one corner to the other right along the page, that's a long journey, but if you fold the page up, it's a real short distance between the two corners. And I gave that explanation once to the filmmakers who were making Deja Vu. I was doing the whole thing, equations, special relativity, general relativity, you know, they're all taking it in, and you know, and then at the end, of course, they say, but wait, but can't we just change a little bit over there so that we can get this or that plot device in? So I said, sure, you can do whatever you want, but it's good to know how these ideas actually work. But I did explain to them this notion of a wormhole and folding a piece of paper, and it's funny because in a scene in Deja Vu, there's a moment where the scientist folds a piece of paper up.
Explain, we could fold the space, bring the target closer to us, create what's known as an Einstein-Rosen bridge, otherwise known as a wormhole, suspend it via gravitational field.
That's what we're looking at.
Well, I mean, they probably knew that explanation before they spoke to me, but it was sort of fun to see that on screen. But if a wormhole is indeed the way you travel through time, because if you have a tunnel from one point in space to another, in principle, you can manipulate time at one opening or the other. You can take the opening of a wormhole and tow it near a black hole. And then time near that opening will slow down compared to time at the other opening. Now, this tunnel is not just a tunnel from one point in space to another point in space. It's a tunnel from one moment in time to a different moment in time. So in principle, if you could pass through that, you would go from one moment to a different moment, going one direction to the future, the other direction would be to the past. And as far as I know, you could keep your clothes on. So in this version of time travel, you know, there wouldn't be a machine per se. You'd basically see the opening of a wormhole, if there were one. It would just be a sphere, a spherical region embedded in our environment. And you would pass into that spherical region and you'd exit another spherical region at a different location in space and a different moment in time. Wormholes may form naturally in the cosmos. We have never encountered any. We've got no evidence for them. But because they do solve Einstein's equations in the general theory of relativity, in principle, they could be out there. Now, the question then arises, could we create them if they don't arise naturally? And people have studied this. And if you had arbitrarily large energy reserves, and moreover, if you had reserves of an exotic kind of energy that can yield a sufficient repulsive force that can sort of push space apart, then in principle you could imagine creating these things, but it's not as though we have a blueprint for how to go about it. So nothing rules them out, but it's not as though we have a go-to manual for how to actually create these exotic cosmological structures.
Here are some of the many things we don't know about heptapods.
There's an age-old question that philosophers, thinkers from many disciplines have asked themselves. To what extent does language itself determine the way that we think about things in the world? We often think about language as a tool to articulate our thoughts, but your tool can often influence the things you're able to do with that tool. And Arrival is an interesting film that explores this idea, because this extraterrestrial life, the heptapods, there's a linguist, and she tries to figure out their language and comes to the conclusion that their written language is not a linear unfolding of some kind of spoken language. Rather, their written language expresses ideas in a kind of atemporal way. I mean, our sentences always have a beginning, a middle, and an end. We're going somewhere through time in our sentences, but the heptapod language has these beautiful logograms, I think they're called, these circular patterns that the heptapods use to communicate their ideas.
Like their ship or their bodies, their written language has no forward or backward direction. Linguists call this nonlinear orthography. which raises the question, is this how they think?
And the conceit of the film is that if a human being is able to take in their language, their way of expressing their notions and their ideas, which does not require that temporal linear quality of time that we have, that if a human being can take in that language, the way they experience time will change. And in this film, as I recall, the main character does take in the heptapod language and is able to have memories of the future as opposed to memories of the past. The idea being that this new embrace of a language that itself has an atemporal quality has a profound impact on how we experience time. What makes us humans is that we are able to use language to step outside of time, right? I mean, most animals in the animal kingdom experience life moment by moment by moment. What we can do is we can lift ourselves above the timeline because we can use language to describe and discuss the past, use language to describe and discuss things that have not yet occurred, the future. It's language by which we navigate freely through time. So if we had a different language, naturally you would wonder, would we navigate through time? Would we think about time in a different way? I think part of the reason why there have been so many attempts to fashion a version of time travel, be it in literature or film or other art forms, is because we recognize that time is the most precious thing that we have. It's deeply mysterious. Where does it come from? Is there a substance called time? Or is it just human perception overlaid on reality? And to try to come to grips with this most precious quality of the world that's deeply mysterious, what we do is we use human imagination to explore it. If we can't manipulate time in the real world, let's manipulate it in our imagination to give us a sense of control and a sense of connection to this deeply influential idea. And this is what we humans have done since the very first storytellers. In those stories, we see our forebears trying to imagine a world in which they would have powers, or in which there would be beings that they could supplicate to that would have powers to affect the world, the reality that they inhabit. And that's what we do. We try to gain power and insight and control and a sense of comfort with the greatest of mysteries by virtue of telling stories about them. Thank you for watching. And if you want to check out more videos like this, you can subscribe to the Penguin YouTube channel. You just got to click right over here. And if you want to check out my book, Until the End of Time, you can click on the link in the description below. Thanks a lot. Bye.